Assalamualaikum and hello. Today I will be talking on a very important topic for all students, which is on communication skills and more importantly, how to be an effective communicator. So there's quite a lot of topics or titles that I'm going to cover, but I will try to make it easy for you to understand. So basically, I'll just be discussing the basics about what is meant by communication, and I'll be talking about examples of communication skills, and more importantly, how to be an effective communicator. So let's try to understand what do we mean by communication, and why has time and time again, the lack of communication skills has been highlighted as one of the major weaknesses amongst our graduates, especially graduates from Malaysian universities. So, what is communication? So, communication actually comes from the word Latin, which is communicate or to share. So, we have to understand that it is all about sharing. And when we try to understand what sharing means, communication is always about an interaction of two or more people, and there has to be the understanding of meaning between the people. So to understand the meaning, we have to use signs, and those are the things that we need communication skills, because to convey and to share those ideas effectively using those signs and using our abilities when we receive and when we send different types of information will require skills. And those skills will therefore influence the type of communication that is the outcome, which is an effective communication, where we understand the meaning, we understand the message. And communication, we have to understand, is not only just about us communicating what we want to convey. Communication also involves listening and understanding the meaning. So the important aspect in communication is to know what are the elements of the communication process. First, we know that there is a sender of the communication, and to send that message, there has to be a medium, and of course, any messages, there has to be a receiver. And the part that is most important is the feedback of the message that is received. So if we look at these elements of the communication process, there has to be a sender, which is the source of the message. The sender has to encode the message through and send it and transmits it through a channel. And the receiver, when the receiver receives the message, the receiver has to decode that message and then gives a response. And that response has to go back to the sender in the form of a feedback. And this is where most of the problems lie. When we have noise that disturbs the communication between the sender and the receiver, noise that disturbs the communication of the response, such that when the sender receives the feedback, the noise disrupts the message as well as the response that the sender has tried to convey to the receiver and the receiver trying to convey to the sender. So we have to understand these elements of the communication process. So, and I have been telling you again and again, what do we mean by effective communicator? Okay. So it is important that we must convey the message correctly, thoroughly. And when we receive the message, we understand what the message is and we can respond accordingly to the message. And to do that, when we're talking about verbal communication, we have to speak in a clear, direct manner, using language that is understood, as well as non-verbal communication. And I'll go over that shortly. So what are the types of communication skills that we require in communication? So I've mentioned this in passing. So we usually use verbal communication. we also have non-verbal communication, and we also usually have written communication. And there's also visual communication and interpersonal communication. You have to understand and let us put in the context of between students and lecturers. So as I describe each of these elements, you try to visualize and try to understand what it means in your context or in the context of communication for a student. So let's do this. Let's try and understand each of these type of communication skills and see the examples in your context. The first one, verbal communication. That's the most common type of communication that is used between sender and receiver. We use words when we use verbal communication. We also, so what do we need to make sure that it's an effective verbal communication? So the first is your voice. You have to make sure that you are speaking in a clear voice, in a confident voice, in a strong voice, but not too loud. It has to be of a moderate tone. And I emphasize this, it's not just about the sender of the message, it's also the receiver of the message. The receiver must employ active listening. And when you speak, this is a common mistake that all of us make. We always use fillers. What are examples of fillers? Sometimes we repeat certain words. That's an example of filler. So you must control yourself and make sure that you don't use fillers. And I'm trying not to use fillers as well as I'm delivering this topic to you. And another thing, I know that when you're teenagers, you tend to use certain slangs that teenagers use in verbal communication, especially in formal communication. Please try to control yourself and avoid those slangs. Now look at the second type of communication, written communication. Usually it's interesting when we talk about Malaysian students or international students, whenever you're communicating written versus oral, it's interesting that we find that we do better in written communication. Why? Because in written communication, we can actually use technology to rewrite. We can use tools to correct what has been written. So like my problem is I keep on rewriting and rewriting what I have written because I want it to be perfect. And I tell you, that's a weakness. So in a written communication, what you do is you just write it down. And another tendency that we have is we try to write the sentence so in such a long sentence that at the end of the sentence, when we reach the full stop, we don't understand what the whole sentence means. So what you have to do is you have to write in a simple language and just use short sentences. Be concise. Be clear. Okay, when you write in those letters or reports. So avoid sentences that run over a few lines. So the minute when you see the sentence going more than two or three lines, you know, oh, this sentence is too long. So you try to shorten that up. Okay. And another thing about written communication is your grammar. So I've mentioned about tools. So there's a variety of tools that we can use to correct our grammar and our punctuation. So just use those tools. So make sure when you send the report, the assignment, the thesis or whatever project report to your lecturer, make sure you have done all the necessary to ensure that there are no grammatical mistakes, there are no formatting mistakes, there are no punctuation mistakes. And always use an active voice. So what do we mean by an active versus a passive voice when we do written communication? So an active voice means you write in the first person rather than you write in the third person. Okay? So writing in the active voice or in the first person means you say I rather than she was or the author was, as if you're referring to another person. So that's another tip that you should remember when you do written communication. Okay, so we've done the verbal, we've done the written communication, which is fairly easy. Now I'm going to go into the next part, the non-verbal communication. I tell you, nonverbal communication cannot be dismissed in terms of its importance. Why do I say that? Because especially when it's verbal communication, is what you say, but at the same time, you have all these other modes of communicating. Okay, so examples of body language, like for example, you see that I've been using my hands a lot, and I use my eye contact and my facial expression. Imagine if I'm just sitting here and reading and saying, there are three types of communication and my face is expressionless and I don't move my hands. I don't move my body. I just stay very still, very straight and just say. Imagine those two scenarios. And imagine yourself as a presenter. Let's say you're presenting your project or your assignment. Imagine yourself in the front of the classroom, or even if, let's say, we're now doing a lot of presentations online because of the pandemic situation. Even then, the nonverbal communication is important. Yes, you do see the screen. You do see your face there. But at the same time, there's a lot of nonverbal communication going on there. The tone of your voice, the pitch of your voice, whether you're speaking in a low tone or in a high tone, or whether you're shouting or whether you're whispering. So those are important nonverbal communication that you have to use. So what are the tips? Always maintain eye contact. Use your facial expressions. We're not wearing a mask. I have to mention this. Nowadays, everywhere we go, we have to wear a mask. And what's the only thing that we can see when we have a mask? I should have brought my mask so that I can demonstrate. Okay. So, with a mask, what do you see? You only see your eyes. But, so does that mean that the communication is less effective? Yes, it does affect the communication. But this is the opportunity where you can speak through your eyes. So you have to learn how to communicate through your eyes. Okay? Because your face, whole face, basically the whole of your face is covered. Okay? So be aware also. Remember I said it's not just a speaker, it's the listener, the receiver. So you have to be aware of those tones and sounds and be aware of the reaction that you're getting from the receiver. You have to also keep a good posture. Mind your posture. And I have to mention this. Be considerate of personal space, especially in our culture. What do we mean by personal space? When we're communicating between two persons or more, everyone has a personal space. Do not intrude into the personal space, especially if the person is not your best friend or is not your immediate family. If it's a stranger, especially if it's your lecturer, please do not invade your lecturer's personal space and treat your lecturer like your friend and go and put hi or just, you know, approach. No, do not do that, okay, with your lecturers. So likewise, even with your friends, be careful and be aware that everyone has a personal space. Visual communication, we like to use this. Okay, we have visual aids. So I'm also using a visual aid. I have this presentation slides for you to see so that you can see the points there. Whenever you want to use visual communication, make sure you get permission and you inform that you're using this visual communication, and please only use it if it adds value. Because sometimes, why I sometimes don't like to use PowerPoint slides or presentation slides or other visual communication, especially if it's a lot of text, we have a tendency of reading the text and we lose the meaning of the message and we lose the impact of the message. So the purpose of the visual communication is just to aid the communication of the message so that the message is more clear. The last type, now this is what communication is all about. We have understood, we have seen, okay, we have verbal communication, nonverbal communication, we have visual communication, but it's all about interpersonal communication. I've emphasized that communication is not just one-way communication. You have the response and you have the feedback, and it goes back and forth, back and forth in terms of the communication. And this whole process of exchanging the information, exchanging ideas, even to the point of exchanging feelings between two or more people using those verbal, non-verbal methods is what we mean by interpersonal communication. So in interpersonal communication, you must give your whole attention to the communication that you are having with the other person or with the group of people. The biggest mistake that we always have in this age of technology and social media is that we're supposed to be communicating with the person who's in front of us or with us, but what do we do instead? You see, let's say there's your friend there, or even I'll give a worse example. Let's say you at a dining table, eating with supposedly your family or your friends. But what are you doing? Or what's everyone on that dining table doing? Everyone is like looking at their phone. That is what technology is making us do nowadays. Yeah. So please give full attention. So I always make it a policy whenever someone comes dining with me or someone comes to see me for a meeting, please leave your phone. Either put it in your bag or put it outside. Just put it out of the contact. Even if you put your phone face down on the table, even that, I still find it very offensive. Don't do that. Okay, please try not to do that. So keep your phone, make it out of sight. Because that is what we call by noise. Remember what I said about noise? So when you hear the message coming in through whatever beeps or whatever sound that the phone is making, that's a noise, that's a distraction, and it's interrupting the conversation. Okay? So I have to mention one thing about communication. Communication is all about sincerity, how you feel. And it is obvious if your sincerity is not there. Okay? We can sense it when someone is not sincere. So I've given different examples of what we mean by barriers to effective communication. And that's the whole problem that we have nowadays. Why we cannot be an effective communicator? It is because of these barriers to effective communication. So what are types of barriers to effective communication? Sometimes we actually have physical barriers. Okay. What's an example of a physical barrier? Something physical obstructs. Okay, that's an obstruction. Something physical that is obstructing the communication between the sender and the receiver. If it's a physical barrier, it's easy. You just remove the physical barrier. The more difficult part is the perceptual barrier. You know what we mean by perceptual barrier? There is no physical barrier there, but we can sense, we perceive that there is a barrier. What's an example? You go to see your lecturer, for example, or your academic advisor, or your counselor. You're all ready to share your problems and pour your problems. And then sometimes, but I hope it doesn't happen in UTM, sometimes we can perceive that there is a barrier there. We perceive that somehow the other person does not want to communicate with us. So that is what we mean by some kind of barrier. But sometimes this barrier is just perception. So please move away all these perceptions of barriers. Because sometimes it's just in your mind that you perceive that there is this barrier. Because maybe you feel that that person is too powerful, or you perceive that there is a big gap between you as the sender or the receiver of the communication, and therefore you don't see yourself on equal length, or you're not standing the same height. So those are perceptions that has to be removed. We also have emotional barriers. Okay, when it deals with emotions, We have, okay, in UTM, we have different students from different countries, from different cultures. So we have cultural barriers. When we first had international students coming to UTM, we had a culture shock. Malaysians had a culture shock. Why? Because international students tend to speak very loud. And sometimes you perceive, take note, perception. You perceive as if that person is angry because that person shouts or talks in a loud voice. Because Malaysians are more used to speaking softer. But that's just a cultural barrier, because some students come from a cultural background where their voice and their tone of voice is such that they speak very loud and they speak in a high tone or they speak forcefully. And language barrier is another type of barrier. Sometimes we don't understand the language or we're not as competent in terms of the language that is being spoken. But that can be addressed. That's not a big problem. There's also gender barrier. Okay, when we're talking between different genders, male and female. And we also have sometimes religious barriers. So those are the different types of barriers. And we also have interpersonal barriers. And I've actually implied this when I tried to describe the different types of barriers. So one type of interpersonal barrier is you just withdraw. You just withdraw yourself. You don't even contact your lecturer. You have a problem. You have a personal problem, but you withdraw. You don't communicate with your friends. You don't communicate, what more, with your lecturer. You don't tell your problems to your academic advisors, to your lecturers, to those who might be able to help you. Please avoid that. Do not withdraw. Because withdrawal means you don't want to be communicated. You don't want to communicate. Another type of barrier that is interpersonal is sometimes we do certain rituals. And those are rituals that doesn't have any meaning. Yeah. So rituals, that means something that we do each and every time. It takes up time, but it is actually a barrier to the communication. And we do it every time. Okay. I want you to think about what are rituals that you are using that actually are devoid of meaning. Okay. We also have barriers in terms of pastimes that we fill up time with others in social, but it's very, very superficial. It doesn't have any meaning. Okay. We also have, when we do communication or activities, that we try very much to follow the rules, the SOP. But they are just SOP. They are just rules. They are just procedures. They are nothing more than that. And you're not communicating. And sometimes, now this happens also, we play games. We play these subtle games, games that we play between best friends, for example. And sometimes we also have games that we play between students and lecturers. Games that we play because we have an excuse, actually, that we didn't complete the assignment. So, but we don't actually communicate and explain why we didn't complete the assignment. Okay, so don't play games. Be direct, but it can also be implicit, but then please do not play games. When we say playing games, that means you're manipulating the situation. And it's always, when we talk about games, it's always about someone winning and someone losing. We don't want that in our effective communication. And finally, the purpose of interpersonal contact is closeness. Okay. Sometimes we want to be close. Okay, we want to have that closeness, but that closeness should not be a barrier to us having an effective communication. It's a bit complicated about that. You will have to try and think about it, because we will have to do exercises with your lecturers to see what we mean by each of these barriers to effective communication. So, what you need to do now with your lectures and with your class and with your peers is think of examples of students' effective communication. We've seen these different types of communication, so we should be looking at examples and samples of the verbal communication that you have. So you think about the different stakeholders that you have with your peers, with your friends, with your group mates, with your dorm mates, with your roommates, with your neighbors. What are the examples of non-verbal communication that you have with them? Do you use any visual communication and written communication? Now, this is the most common that we have, especially in formal communication. So for formal communication, we usually use written communication. Look at the written communication that you have. But please don't use slangs. Please don't use jargons. Please don't use those text messages, icons or GIFs to communicate in your formal communication. So be careful of those. But look at those examples because we learn from them. Okay. So on that note, again, I hope that you can now understand what we mean by communication skills and how to be an effective communicator. Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.